conditions which underpinned the search for a new theatre were the same which underpinned the dismissal of theatre. The reformers of the theatre rearranged them by borrowing from the Platonician dispositif another idea of the theatre. Plato opposed to the poetic and democratic community of the theatre, the true community, a choreographic community where nobody remains motionless, where everybody is moving according to the rhythm of the community, which is the rhythm of mathematical proportion. The reformers of the theatre reframed the opposition between choreia and theatre as an opposition of the true theatre to the simulacrum of the spectacle, or the passivity of the spectacle. The theatre then became the place where passive spectatorship had to be turned into its contrary, the living body of a community enacting its own principle. In the text introducing the topic of this academy, we can read this sentence: "Theater remains the only place of direct confrontation of the audience with itself as a collective." Well, in the context of this paper, we can give to that proposition a restrictive meaning, merely opposing the collective audience of the theater to the individual visitor of an exhibition, the lonely audience of the TV, or the mere collection of individuals looking at a movie. But obviously, this means something more. This means that theater remains a name for an idea of the community as a living body, as a kind of self-presence or presence to itself against representation. Since German Romanticism, theater has been associated with that kind of community. It appeared as part of the aesthetic constitution, meaning the sensory constitution of the community. The community as a way of occupying time and space, as a set of living gestures and attitudes which stands before any kind of political form and institution. Community as a performing body instead of a collection of forms and rules. In that way, theater was associated with the romantic idea of the aesthetic revolution, the idea of a revolution which would not only change laws and institutions, but change sensory forms of human experience. The reform of theater thus meant the restoration of its authenticity as an assembly or a ceremony of the community. Theater is an assembly where the people become aware of their situation and discuss their own interests. This is a Brechtian statement. Theater is a ceremony where the community is given the possession of its own energy. This is the Artaudian statement. If theater is put as an equivalent of the true community, the living body of the community opposed to mimesis, it comes as no surprise that even the attempt at restoring theatre in its true essence take place on the very background of the critique of the spectacle. What is the essence of the spectacle in Guy Debord's theory? The essence of the spectacle for him is externality. The spectacle is the reign of vision. Visions means externality. Now, externality means dispossession of one's own being. The more man contemplates, the less he is, Debord says. This may sound anti-Platonician, and obviously the main source for the critique of the spectacle is not Plato, it's Feuerbach. It is the romantic idea of truth as unseparateness. But that idea itself still keeps in line with the Platonician disparagement of the mimetic image. The contemplation that Debord denounces is the theatrical or mimetic contemplation, the contemplation of the suffering which is provoked by division. Separation, he says, is the alpha and the omega of the theater, because what man contemplates precisely is the activity that has been stolen to him It is his own essence, torn away from him, became foreign to him, hostile to him, making for a collective world, the reality of which is nothing but his own dispossession. In such a way, there is no contradiction between the search for a theater achieving its own essence and the critic of the spectacle. The good theater thus was posited as a theater that uses its separate reality in order to suppress it, to turn the theatrical form into a form of life of the community. The paradox of the spectator is part of this intellectual dispositif which keeps in line, in the name of the theater, with the Platonician dismissal of the theater. This disposition still set to works, I think, some ground ideas which I assume have to be brought back into question. More precisely, what has to be called into question is the very footing on which those ideas are based. It is a whole set of relations resting on some key equivalences and some key oppositions, equivalence of theater and community, of seeing and passivity, of externality and separation, mediation and simulacrum. Oppositions between collective and individual, image and reality, activity and passivity, self-possession and alienation. This set of equivalences and oppositions made for a rather tricky dramaturgy of guilt and redemption. Theater was charged with making spectators passive, while its very essence was supposed to consist in the self-activity of the community. As a consequence, it set itself the task of reversing its own effect and compensating for its own guilt by giving back to the spectators their self-consciousness or self-activity. The theatrical stage and the theatrical performance thus became the vanishing mediation between the evil of the spectacle and the virtue of theater. It proposed to the collective audience performances intended to teach the spectators how they could stop to be spectators and become participants in a collective action. Either, according to the Brechtian paradigm, the theatrical mediation made them aware of the social situation or on which it rested itself and prompted them to act as a consequence of that awareness, or, according to the Arthurian paradigm, they left the position of spectators. They were no more in front of a spectacle, but surrounded by the performance, dragged into the circle of the performance, which gave them back their collective energy. This idea of a self-suppressing theatrical mediation is the point where the descriptions and propositions of Jacotot's intellectual emancipation can get into the picture and perhaps help us reframe it. Obviously, this idea of a vanishing mediation or a self-suppressing process is well known to us. It is a pedagogical scheme. In the pedagogical scheme, the action of the schoolmaster is posited as the act of suppressing the distance between his knowledge and the ignorance of the ignorant. His lessons and exercises are aimed at relentlessly reducing the gap between knowledge and ignorance. The trouble, Jacotot said, is that in order to reduce it, it has to reinstate it continuously. In order to replace ignorance by the adequate knowledge, the master must always be one step ahead of the ignorant who loses his ignorance. Because in that scheme, the ignorant is not only the one who doesn't know what he doesn't know. He is the one who ignores that he doesn't know what he doesn't know and ignores how to know it. So the master is not only the one who exactly knows what remains unknown to the ignorant. He also knows how to make it knowable, at what time and what place, according to what scheme. On the one hand, pedagogy is set up as a process of objective and adequate transmission, One part of knowledge